The Long Island man convicted of killing his family, whose murders spawned the Amityville horror franchise, has died. State corrections officials confirmed that Ronald DeFeo died today at a hospital upstate at the age of 69.
Welcome to Reporter Room, where we seek truth and justice. My name is Jessica Della Davies. I'm an investigative journalist. Today, we're going to discuss the haunting of the Amityville home. The story of the Amityville horror. Was it real or was it a hoax? You decide, and please leave me your opinion in the comment section below when you finished watching the video. Everything I'm about to share with you is my opinion, and opinions are not facts, so please don't send any negativity to anyone, anytime, anywhere. Let's be kind to each other. The movie The Amityville Horror was partly inspired by the real-life murders committed by a man named Ronald DeFeo Jr. Jr. was convicted of killing his entire family in their Amityville, Long Island home in 1974. His victims included both of his parents, his two younger sisters, along with his two younger brothers. At the time, Jr. claimed he arrived home and found everyone, just happened to all be deceased. However, his story kept changing, and his story continues to change, even after he was convicted and given six sentences of 25 years to life in prison, one for each family member. DeFeo's attorney was a man named William Weber. Put a pin in the name William Weber because his name comes up a lot in this story, and I'm going to reveal why to you shortly. From the time of his arraignment, Weber tried to claim the insanity defense. The attorney and DeFeo both blamed Ronald DeFeo Sr., who was the father, for Junior's actions. Attorney Weber initially presented the argument that Junior had been bullied by his father. Before we go any further, please subscribe and give this video a thumbs up so I know you were here. Also, I have an awesome Reporter Room true crime group on Facebook if you're interested. So the case went to trial in October of 1975, and this was only months before the Lutzes would buy the infamous Ocean Avenue house and move in with their three children. DeFeo's attorney hired a psychiatrist who claimed DeFeo had been in a state of paranoid psychosis on that night. And the psychiatrist the prosecution hired agreed that DeFeo Jr. was mentally ill, but he also stated that Jr. knew the difference between right and wrong. Therefore, Jr. was not legally insane. The jury agreed with the prosecution and sentenced Jr. to the six concurrent life sentences. Let's fast forward a few months, and George and Kathy Lutz, a married couple in their mid-30s, purchased the Amityville home for a massive discount. They appeared to be the typical couple with three children. The family moved into the house and reported that a scary paranormal activity occurred during the 28 days that they lived there. This included, as reported in the original book, which was written by Jay Anson, with the well-paid cooperation of George and Kathy Lutz, and later in the screenplay Anson wrote for the 1979 original Amityville horror film, green slime leaking from the door keyholes, a spirit yelling, "Get out!
Get out! Get out!"
to a visiting priest, Father Pecoraro. Their daughter seen and speaking with an imaginary friend named Jody that appears to her as a pig with red glowing eyes. George Lutz, the father, also sees in his window a pig with red glowing eyes. The family also claimed that cold spots began to appear mysteriously in the home, and also that a room filled with flies appears. They reported that there were strange smells in the house that reportedly came and went. In fact, George told ABC News in 2006 that there was, quote, also sounds. The front door would slam shut in the middle of the night, and he couldn't get warm in the house for many days. The Lutzes also claim that when they moved in, that they had a priest come and bless the house. And George claimed that the priest felt an invisible hand slap him in the sewing room. George also claimed he heard a voice ordering the priest to get out. Get out. George says he would also mysteriously wake up at 3:15 a.m. nearly every night, and this was the same time that the DeFeo family was believed to have been murdered. George also says at times his wife would magically turn into an elderly woman and levitate from their bed. He also says that he heard his children's beds slamming up and down on the floor, but says he couldn't do anything to stop this or protect his children because an invisible force was paralyzing him and keeping him in bed. 28 days after the Lutzes left their home, claiming that the paranormal activity had followed them to their hotel, a local TV crew did a segment on the house bringing in so-called ghost hunters and paranormal experts to evaluate the Lutzes' claims. The ghost hunter team took photographs inside the home and they captured this creepy image that was some kind of a quote ghost boy peeking out from one of the bedrooms. There were no children in the house at this time, so this image was very unsettling. The ghost hunters also agreed with the Lutz family that there was some kind of demonic force present in the home. During press interviews, George did a lot more of the talking than his wife Kathy. He came across as someone who was reluctantly telling his story, and this probably gave his story more credibility. He said he didn't want to get into the details. However, George did say that a very strong force had driven his family out of their Amityville home. Was it a hoax? Many people expressed doubts about the Lutz's story. The Lutz's story became even more dubious after Junior's defense attorney, William Weber, admitted that he and the Lutz parents concocted the story over several bottles of wine. So Junior's attorney, Weber, said that they took real life occurrences and then transposed them. And he said this in an interview on A Current Affair, which was a television show back in May of 1988. Weber stated that the whole thing was a hoax. George Lutz's stepson, Daniel, who was 10 at the time, claims to this day that his stepfather, George, let dark forces into their lives due to his interest in the occult. Daniel shares his take on what happened inside the Amityville house in a 2013 documentary, quote, My Amityville Horror. In contrast, George's other stepson, Kristen Quarantino, who was 7 at the time when he lived in the Amityville Horror house, said that the books and movies had stretched the story to the point of fiction. But Christopher also said that George was infatuated with the occult. And although he had exaggerated some of the paranormal incidences, Christopher claims that he believes something did occur when he and his parents were living in the Amityville home. So for your consideration, while you're deciding whether you think this was a hoax or it really occurred, both of the children believe that something occurred inside the home and have stuck to the story into their adult lives. And they believe both believe that it was caused by George's interest in the occult. And while Christopher believes George's interest in the occult led to the exaggerations of what happened, Daniel believes that it caused what happened. So the Amityville house has been bought and sold multiple times since the Lutzes lived there. However, no one else has reported any spooky happenings. Of course, this is conveniently explained away because the Lutz say that the dark forces followed them when they left the home. Kathy passed away in 2004 and George followed in 2006. But while George was alive, he continued to give a few more interviews. He continued to insist that the family had experienced a horror, but he came to admit that certain elements of the story, like the green slime in particular, were embellished. George's admission made people doubt the whole thing even occurred. Many believed that Weber was telling the truth and that it was a simple case of a hoax gone too far. Weber, who admitted he had fallen out with the couple over money, said he had passed them detailed information about Junior Defoe and what he did on that night, and that they had spun these details into a fantastical ghost story. Weber stated, quote, "I told George Lutz that Ronnie DeFeo used to call the neighbor's cat a pig. George was a con artist. He improvised on that, and in the end, he sees a demon pig through a window." So if you're thinking this was all about money, you might be right, because the Lutzes, they ended up filing a lawsuit against attorney Weber for invasion of privacy, with George saying, "We're tired of being called liars." Then Weber retaliated by countersuing the Lutzes for fraud and breach of contract. In court, George Lutz admitted that he earned $100,000 from the book and another $100,000 for the film. The judge stated emphatically that it appeared to him that the Amityville horror novel was a, quote, work of fiction. The judge tossed out the Lutz's case, while Weber's claim was settled out of court for $2,500. There are many holes in the Lutz's claims. People wonder why the Lutz never photographed or filmed any of the evidence of paranormal happenings. People also wondered why none of the green slime, for example, was filmed, photographed, or collected. However, the Lutz stuck to most of their story and even passed a lie detector test. Although it needs to be said that they conceded parts of the horror story had been exaggerated, they blamed most of the inconsistencies on the retelling that they did for the book and the original film. So that tiny little red room in the basement, which was purported to be a sort of gateway to hell and source of evil, that George found behind the shelves, for example, it wasn't a secret. The house's previous owner stated that they had used that room for storage. The Lutz also admitted that the bathrooms had not overflowed with a hellish black sludge as depicted in the original movie. The priest, who supposedly had blessed the house and had been told to, quote, get out, stated he had never, ever even visited the Lutz's Amityville home. And Defoe Jr.'s attorney, Weber, told the court that the Lutzes had been interested in, quote, developing the demonism aspect of the case. Providing more insight into the couple's supposed creative powers, attorney Weber claimed that he told George and Kathy Lutz that Ronald DeFeo Jr.'s father had once hit his mom while he was carrying a plate of spaghetti. This caused her to fall down the basement stairs and tomato sauce splashed on the walls. Weber claimed that this is where the idea of the green slime came from. So remember that Weber was the attorney for Jr. during his trial, and Weber admitted that he had realized that the sensational murders would make a great film or book, but he insisted that it had never influenced his defense of DeFeo Jr. But it does make you wonder if DeFeo Jr. got a reputable representation in court, because his attorney seemed to have a personal stake in making money from the sale of the book and the movie. And although the book details extensive damage to the home's doors and hardware, the original locks, doorknobs, and hinges were actually untouched and not damaged in any way. The book and the film show police being called to the house, and that supposedly scared the Lutz family into leaving the home, but according to the record, no one from the Lutz family ever really called the authorities before they left the Amityville house. So the Lutzes made hundreds of thousands of dollars from the book and film rights. And it's worth noting that all of this occurred around the time the film The Exorcist came out. So was that an influence on this story. Do you think that this movie helped lay the groundwork for the Amityville horror story? Subscribe and let me know in the comment section if you think the Amityville horror was real or if you think it was a hoax.